Welcome to Name and Occupation in Depth. Today we have Paul Bauer on the show. Paul was booted out of High Stores Grammar School in 1973 for laziness. He joined the groundbreaking youth arts workshop Meat Whistle, where he took up guitar duties with proto-punk undergroup Musical Vomit. He co-wrote heartwarming classics as Laxative Lament and I Was a Teenage Necrophiliac with frontman Mark Civico, aka Trigay Thug. He also went on to fund Punk Funcy Gun Robber. There's so much in this bio that I would love to unpack. Paul, so great to have you. Welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm phoning in from Sheffield, England.
So
Welcome.
unbelievable. I can't believe that we're able to do this virtually. It's awesome that we're able to facilitate it. And also I have here that I forgot to scroll down. I'm going to continue actually. That in 19 in
I packed a
19
lot in.
I want to know just I'm going to just put a little bit more in your bio just because I don't want to miss this important piece. In 1977, you founded 2.3, which was the first punk band in Sheffield and the first Sheffield group to sign a contract. You also played an important role in the history of the Human League by introducing them to Fast Records and arranging their first gig.
I was on the mixing desk.
Paul, I want you to tell us your story. That's what I want you to do. I
Yeah.
want you to tell us your
Okay.
story.
Just
How did this happen? How did you get to
Right.
this,
Well,
how did this all start?
okay. So I'm booted out of school in 1973, not for being a bad guy. There's no drugs involved. There's quite a lot of kind of raw cider involved in my expulsion from school. And the first job I got was working in a supermarket, the local co-op. And as part of that, basic stuff, stacking shelves, pork butchery, slicing up bacon, this kind of thing on the bacon and cheese counter. And the other guy who got a similar job to me had been in a similar situation, and he was booted out or asked or let he actually left of a top grammar school in Sheffield because he just didn't like school, but he was a super smart guy. And his name was Martyn Ware. Now, Martyn Ware was the guy. He's always interested in music. He was into early Roxy music, into German experimental music and things. And we're working together in the supermarket. And he tells me about his plans to start, maybe to start making music. And these are just like crazy dreams of two 17, 18-year-olds. And Martyn then, as the kind of punk scene started, Martyn was more into synthesizers, and he formed first, a group called The Future, which people can find online. Called There's an album of their early tapes out called The Golden Era of the Future, which then, transformed into the Human League. And he brought in one of his old schoolmates, Phil Oakey, he of the lopsided haircut, in to be the singer. Phil had never been on stage before and never sung before, but a charismatic guy, about 6 foot 2. And he wore women's platform boots. So he was quite an imposing character with his leather
Cool.
jacket on and his hair. This time he didn't have the lopsided hair. He had just had long hair with a big blonde streak dyed in it and black nail varnish. As you can imagine, he cuts quite an imposing figure in a kind of northern steel town, which is a bit like a small kind of version of like Pittsburgh. And so we get together, we all club together, put money in for rent of like a kind of a disused small factory, and that was where we rehearsed. So in one room, there'd be us. In another room, there'd be a band called Clock DVA, and in the other room, there'd be 2.3 in one room, Clock DVA in another, and the early Human League making their early sounds, including the tracks which went on to become to their first classic single, which they still play at gigs, Being Boiled and the Circus of Death, in the middle of Sheffield, a northern steel town. We're doing stuff like 24 hours a day. People are dropping in, they're dropping out, and I'm playing in my band with Paul Schaff, the great drummer Aidan Boys Weston, behind the kit. And the Humour League start, and they're starting to put together these amazing sounds. And I couldn't do that. I can't operate a synthesizer. I'm a guitarist. And I said, are you going to do any gigs? And they said, well, we can't really do gigs, Paul. I said, well, what's that? I said, well, because lots of our sounds are like on tape. And I said, well, get the tape recorder, which carries all the rhythm track, stick it on a table at the back of the stage and play like that. I said, people will be fine about it, providing you're not hiding the tape recorder. And so their first groundbreaking gig, where everybody predicted, except me and about two other people, Human League would never, ever sell any records, was at the Art College in Sheffield in February 1978, with them playing, I think, about 45 minutes, maybe, with his tape recorder at the back, now with Phil Oakey with his asymmetrical lopsided haircut, Ian Craig Marsh on one synthesizer, and Martyn Ware on the other synthesizer. And, you know, it's working. It's going now pretty well, and nobody's heard anything like this live. And during an instrumental break, Phil Oakey, that's, by the way, the later Human League, when they became a major pop group.
Oh, I see.
So this is not them. No, that's important to make that distinction.
Okay.
The only one who's from the original lineup will be Phil at this point. So that's when they become a major pop act.
Okay.
So Phil walks. So it's an instrumental break. He walks off the stage, small stage, and he walks through the audience. And he's a really nervous guy, a terrible stage fright. And he said, Paul, how's it going? And I said, Phil, it's going really well. But it's traditional in music for the lead singer to actually stay on the stage. And, oh, okay. And walks back. And so that's how, you know, so that's how it started. And of course, the Human League, with the first two albums, Reproduction, Travelogue, gained a great cult status, but it didn't work out for them. They, you know, they fell out, there's tensions, the manager was involved in some manipulation, and they went their separate ways. So there's the first two great albums, cult albums. Martyn, and with my friend Glenn Gregory, Andy and Craig Marsh from the Human League went on to form Heaven 17, who had big hits with things like Temptation. And then Phil brings in the two girls who he'd met at a nightclub called the Crazy Daisy. And everybody at that time said, everybody's sure that the Human League with the two girls and Phil, nice people, but they're not going to sell any records. The next album's Dare, which I think sold 4.5 million records with classics like, Don't You Want Me and The Sound of the Crowd on it. So that's basically, you know, how it's not so much I got involved in it, but that was just the scene. We were all knocking around together. And with a kind of sense, I think, as kind of, you know, 20, 21-year-olds, we've got nothing to lose here. We've got really boring jobs. we're glad to have a job so we can buy clothes, go out, nightclub in, buy a few drinks, pay our parents some money for, you know, for food, which in England then we'd call board and lodging. Pay your board, might give your mum like £5 or £6, £7 or something. We were glad to have those jobs, but we wanted something a bit more exciting. We thought, we'll just give it a shot. And if we only put one single out, that would be considered to be a triumph. If you got a single.
For sure.
And then those people went on to, to do great things. And Martyn Ware, who's been like pretty much my closest friend for 50 years now, and we still spend time together, went on to become, a top producer with Tina Turner, Terence Trent D'Arby, Erasure, and many others. And he quite amusing story. Martyn turned down producing Rod Stewart. And the reason was that Martyn, like myself, is a socialist, and Rod Stewart was a big of Margaret Thatcher, and was actually went on like rallies, say, yeah, vote for Margaret Thatcher. And I was actually in his lovely apartment in West London, so Martin's earning some money there. So we're talking about 1985, 86 now, and Martyn he was on the phone, and he was Rod Stewart's manager at the time. And he just basically said down the phone, you can tell Rod to beep, beep, because I'm not producing anybody who supports beep, beep Margaret Thatcher. Anyway, true story. I was there. So, you know, you've got a situation in, you know, if you look at a map, Sheffield's is city then of about 400,000, you know, a parochial steel town. I mean, I thought that if someone had been to Belgium, they were well-travelled. I first left England like when I was like 15. Yeah, a quiet town, and just these guys and a few women who joined bands a little bit later, just hanging out and trying the best. And then suddenly with the Human League and first, and then with Cabaret Voltaire, who are great friends of ours, who were wildly experimental. You know, just trying to get a life less ordinary, I think. Let's have a stab. So the Human League start taking off, Cabaret Voltaire starts taking off, and the A&R men then descend on Sheffield, thinking this is this kind of creative hub. And there was great interaction between a lot of the bands, and no real competition, people saying we're better than you. The Cabaret Voltaire were just so far out.
So this is like post-punk?
Yeah, it's kind of...
It's like a new thing, right?
It started in 75, I think it was, but this is kind of 77, 78.
All the noises in the world help me change my medicine. One solution, live in suspense. Won't take my time. Enclosing, dream mirror, drawing in beside the walls. Smart aleck, so much freedom. Settle back and listen for the calls. Feelings with great slow laugh. Stand stronger, it won't go. Falling back in each long day. I'm at an all-time low. I'm at an all-time low.
So punk's kind of run its course, you know, with like the Sex Pistols, the Clash still making good records, but people are looking for a new sound. And, you know, I played a role in that. I took the first cassettes. Remember, everybody? Cassette tapes.
Yeah. I sure do. I remember listening to the radio, waiting for the song to come on so that I could press record.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mixtapes.
I took the cassette tape up to the little indie record label that we got signed to just for one single. And I said to Bob Lass from Fast Products, who later went on to manage the Human League, I said, this is the sound of the future. Have a listen. This is what's coming out of Sheffield. This is the sound of the future. And Cabaret Voltaire, who were always, you know, they were very much influenced by, you know, Music Concrete, Stockhausen. And these are working class kids, by the way. These are not the sons of intellectual composers. So working class kids whose parents had jobs in factories and offices. Cabaret Voltaire were just making like really interesting and wild, you know, music like Oh Roger and Nag 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 and Do the Mussolini. By the way, they weren't fascists. It was a piss take of fascism, just a very, very creative time. And I put a gig on at the local theatre, just the kind of studio theatre with about 200 people, and Cabaret Voltaire. I got them on because I just thought these guys are cool. They're just going to annoy everybody with their kind of almost noise terrorism, but they look really cool, by the way. As well, they were very fashionable, very sharp guys.
That's half the battle, man. Looking cool. That's something you can't buy.
Yeah, and they go on, and people are just completely bemused. Some people are into them, and I was outside, you know, just counting the money because we charge people to go in and hearing these weird noises.
Sure.
And this guy, this old, what we thought was an old guy, he was probably about 30, storms out. And he said, you've got to pull the plug on them. I said, well, why? He said, do you know what they're doing? They're destroying a Beatles number. I think they were playing a kind of avant-garde version of She Loves You or something like that. Sacrilege. And I thought, we've made
so
it.
Funny.
Nice.
We've made it. And yeah, Kerry Voltaire then went on to have a big influence out of all proportion to their record sales on the sound of, you know, modern electronic dance music. And you even have like hip hop, you know, more creative hip hop musicians saying, yeah, picked up on a lot of these kind of, you know, using found sounds and treating musically different from Cabaret Voltaire. These three kids who, after rehearsals, would all meet at a pub called the called the Beehive. So that's, you know, that's what it was. I stopped playing in a band at that point in 1980. And I managed to get into university. I ended up doing a Spanish degree. And then I kind of went into more into using my talents, sales talents, to promote bands. And so I was like putting gigs on and managed a band called Floyd Joy, who recorded with Don Was in Detroit. I got Don Was involved just by, you know, we call it the power of blag. And also later managed the great Sheffield pop band ABC. ABC started around 81, 82. And they were the people who'd come to our gigs or come to a Cabaret Voltaire gig, or they'd be at a Human League gig, kind of taking notes and thinking, yeah, these guys are not playing cover versions. They're having a go at it.
Well, they with that documentary you showed me, they called it the birth of electronic pop.
We thought we were the punkiest band in Sheffield. You know, we were laughing at the bands that learned to play guitars because they bothered learning three chords. We didn't even do that. We used one finger.
Being boiled.
I used to go to concerts at the City Hall in Sheffield and just sit there and think, what the fuck is going off, you know, because this is rubbish, you know. I could do better than that. We could all do better than that.
So Chris left Cabaret Voltaire at the gate in 1983.
They wanted to create.
And trained as a sound recordist. And now he's like known to be one of the world's great sound recordists of the natural world. And he's worked with Attenborough and the best and won award awards for his work.
They wanted to create for themselves. And the opportunity was there. You could smell it, you could sense the opportunity was there. To get involved in your own creative environment. Everyone was at it.
Again, I'm like revolutionaries, sonic terrorists, who are going to force people to understand that there's a kind of like a new aesthetic here. You know, we thought we were killing off rock and roll.
First gig's terrified. I bit the inside of my cheek so much there was blood running out.
That's your friend.
I was just could not believe that I was doing this.
None of these guys were natural performers.
He was really ambitious. I just wanted to be like, wanted to show every other group that I felt was a little bit ahead of us that, hey, we're coming up, we're catching up with you, we're going to be taking you on.
There's two documentaries. That she did, Made in Sheffield, about our period, and then one later period, which deals with like bands like Pulp and kind of Northern electro house music, and that's called The Beat is the Law. And I recommend anybody to try to get a hold of those, and they're really, really informative. The second one with Jarvis Cocker, you know, is really excellent. She's Dutch, actually. She met a partner who's from Sheffield on some hippie thing in North India and then ended up moving to Sheffield. So, I mean, the basic stuff, Martyn Ware has his autobiography out, which is called Electronically Yours.
Okay.
Which has just come out on paperback. You'll be able to find that.
People ask me and friends about TV programs during the 70s. I say, I watch TV. 70s, we were out 6 days a week, 7 days a week.
Once more with the voice of Buddha. Feels they carry on your slaughter. Who cares for the little children? You decide to no conviction. Blind revenge on a blameless victim.
It was an absolutely fantastic time. You come out of school and someone says, oh, let's try and go on Top of the Pops then. You go, yeah, all right. And you have a go.
Martyn and Glenn, to assist me on my new single from the Heaven 17 group. These are producers of my recent recording, and this one is called Let's Stay Together. Let me say the sins, babe, since we've been together. Loving you forever is all I need.
He put Tina Turner on one of his albums, Music of Quality and Distinction, which is a, you know, kind of a variety of artists. And she does a great version of The Temptations' Ball of Confusion. And so what he did with another producer, Greg Walsh, was to give her a more modern electronic sound, but keep the soul in a voice. And all his stories about Tina Turner are just fantastic and positive. The ultimate professional, just a really lovely person, no airs and graces, just comes in, sings brilliantly. So when you hear Let's Stay Together, so that moved her from being almost like a kind of nostalgia act. Everybody knew that Tina Turner was brilliant, yeah, but she's like going to be doing one of the smaller Vegas venues or something. But what he did with his production and his playing was take her to a new audience, and that's on Private Dancer, which it got, did that sell, I don't know, 5, 6, 7, 8 million. Records, and said, this is a guy who started his musical career messing around with us on a thing which is called a stylophone. And it was this little thing where you actually had a stylus, a pen, where you picked out the notes. And we used to plug that into my amplifier and he'd pick tunes out. But he always had an amazing ear to pick, to create tunes, to hear a tune on the radio and then play it. But he's not from a musical background at all. Sheffield and Ecclesall Co-op, August 1973. We just got on. We went out for lunch that very first day, and we've been close friends ever since.
Different times.
Wow.
Incredible. It's a fun 50 story. 50-year
friendships, eh? That's cool.
So yeah. And he was like a top record producer and working with like top people in the mid 80s when I just finished university. I was unemployed. But he'd invite me around to his house. Just a very, very generous guy. Always has been.
So you kept doing this till the 90s?
Well, it was on and off, really. I managed Floyd Joy. Floyd Joy were a bunch of very, two really talented brothers, Michael Ward and Sean Ward. And Michael Ward went on to a production career, and he worked with all sorts of top people like Rasheem Murphy and Take That. But they were in a band, and they just basically asked me to manage them. Well, I was still at university as a mature student. I went kind of later in life because I think they just wanted somebody with what we'd call in England the gift of the gab, because they were quite quiet, super talented people. And they were signed to a small deal with Virgin Records, and they wanted Don Was, everybody know, Don Was has now been like the musical director of the Oscars, to produce them. And this is pre-internet, boys and girls, so you can't just find online and find out where they are. And they wanted to get Don involved to produce their album, to record it in Detroit in 1983-84. And they asked me if I'd come to New York with them. So we flew out budget to New York with money borrowed from the record company on Laker Airways. Anybody bit of historical stuff. Well, the first budget airlines out to New York. I stayed with a friend of mine who was working in New York, who stayed in Staten Island. And then they said, so what's the plan for finding Don Was? Don at this time, he's not a major figure. He's a kind of cult figure with Was Not Wars. Musicians really rate him, but he's not really well known to record companies. I think they'd had Was Not Wars had a couple of albums out. And I said, well, look, here's the album, and it's special thanks to his A&R man, who was called Danny. I'm thinking it might have been Finkelstein. He had a kind of classic, you know, Jewish music business name. It might not have been Finkelstein, but it was something like that. And said it's at Geffen Records, and Geffen Records is in the Warner Brothers building. So on the Monday, with my suit on, my little briefcase and tie, I go down, first thing, about 10 o'clock to the Warner Brothers building. And I ring up Geffen Records from the little kind of phone box, you know, at the coffee bar that's in the building. I'd like to speak to Danny. I'm afraid he's busy at the moment. I rang on the hour, every hour, politely said, I've flown over here from London, Virgin Records, blah, blah, blah. We'd like to talk to him about the band, blah, blah, blah. So I'm having my meatloaf and mashed potatoes or whatever, and drinking lots of coffee, obviously no alcohol. By the time, so then I think about 4 o'clock, I ring again. So, yeah, Danny will see you at 5 o'clock. You're a big head of A&R at Geffen Records, man. So I go up on the elevator, I don't know, 25th floor, something like that. And I get out and I look around, and there's like gold and platinum records like everywhere. And, you know, I'm not a nervous person, but I was quite nervous. And I walked in and I opened this door of his big corner office in New York. And he looked at me and he said, Paul, so you've flown over here? Yep. Without an invitation? Yep. To try to find Don Was? Yep. Paul, people don't do that in New York. And I said, yeah, but I'm from Sheffield, we do. And he burst out. And he said, okay, Paul, what you got? So he puts the tape in and he immediately starts grooving, because they're a very, very good band. They're good songwriters. He knows how he's gone here. And then his next question was, he says, next question, Paul, how did you know that Don was in New York? We didn't. Well, what did you find then? Said, well, we'd have flown to Detroit to find him because we wanted to produce the album. He's on the phone to Don. We go around to the Mayflower, I get in touch with the band. They're in an apartment owned by Virgin Records. I think we went round to the Mayflower maybe 8 o'clock. Don plays the three tracks and he's going, yeah, because they're channeling American soul. They, you know, they're kind of soul buffs and they're great, great players. And he said, yeah, I want to do this. I want to produce them at the Sound Suite in Detroit. We'll cut the cost, Paul. We'll do it at nights, you know, when the rates are cheaper. And then he said, so the band have got a full album deal, haven't they? And I've got to admit, I did lie and say, yeah, they do. They have a singles deal, but they had an albums deal by the time I then flew back. I'm still at university at this point. I talked to Virgin Records, and I'm still in touch with Mike Ward, not Sean Ward, and he's a prodigiously talented guy. I mean, I think Mike's so he's Mike's a bit older than me. I think he's probably about 69 or
man, that takes balls, man.
So
it's good.
So, and also the other thing is, always be polite to the secretaries. Firstly, it's the right thing to do, and secondly, if I'd have been saying, hey, I've what do you mean? I've come over from London to New York.
They're the ones who let you into the door, man.
I've got no idea. Still got no idea. So,
oh, funny.
I thought it was going to take me a week possibly to fail. It took me a day to do the deal. I've got the rest of the week off in New York.
Amen.
But another friend, Jim Ashton, who's working on kind of early computers on Wall Street. So we were hanging out in New York, a city that I've always loved, because it's like an English,
it's an awesome
an English city. Kid's version of what America is. I know America's not all like that, but, you know, it's like being in a movie, just walking down the street.
It is. It's true. And the energy too, and the there's no place like it. It's unique. Yeah.
So I managed ABC for their fourth album, Alphabet City, which got some great tracks on it, and they're great tribute to Smokey Robinson when Smokey sings. And we got to, I think, number six in the singles charts, and we had a number one for 1 week. We knocked Bad, Michael Jackson's Bad, off the top spot for 1 week.
I was
very pleased.
Which song was that?
The album Alphabet City knocked the album Bad off number one for 1 week, but the song, the big hit from the album, was When Smokey Sings, which is a real kind of Tamla Motown soul groove, and you know, if you can pick up, you'll get that anywhere on the on the internet. And
well, that's no small feat, I can tell
no.
you.
No. Right, that's pretty cool.
Pretty incredible.
And,
and
Smokey got in touch with them to thank them, and they did a radio interview when the great Smokey Robinson said, "Thanks, guys. It's nice to know that you know my work's appreciated by you guys in London town." but then my management career kind of fizzled out, as they do, and then I had to kind of get a proper job. But, you know, great. And I've had some other good jobs. I worked at the Millennium Dome, for instance,
it's good to do something new too, right?
Yeah, but it sounds like you dabble in so many things. Like you created a fan scene called Gun Rubber. What's that?
Gun Rubber, the whole Gun Rubber thing was in 1976, 77. And I very, very briefly lived in London when I was 20 years old. We ran a junk shop north of one of the main railway stations, King's Cross, quite a scuzzy, heavy area. And we slept in like a cellar underneath the shop for this was about 6 months. So I've been in London, but it was too much for me. So I went back to my mum's. My dad died when I was a child, when I was 12 years old. So it was mum. Mum was the rock, basically. Mm. And so I went back to my mother's. And I'd seen this punk scene kind of developing. At first, I didn't get into it. Then I understood it was great to shake things up, you know, all this prog rock nonsense with these guitar solos that went on for 3 days. We went into but there were punk fanzines like Sniffing Glue, and I thought, they're not very good.
No,
Jeffrey, we could do better than that. And we launched this fanzine, which had a mixture. You had creative writing in there by a crazy friend of ours who didn't really like punk at all. He was into jazz and, you know, Charlie Parker, bebop, reviews of bands that were coming into Sheffield, tips on how to form a band, tips on where to buy, cheap equipment, and just generally encouraging people to write their own material and not to do covers
and create a scene in the same.
Yeah, I reviewed like the first Cabaret Voltaire cassette that they actually sold locally, and that was picked up, you know, Gun Rubber was sold in shops around England, and then it went out to the States as well. And so I did play a small part in kind of shining a light on what was happening in Sheffield, because what happened with the fanzines was that we created this fanzine, like Xerox cover and Gestetner pages. Mm-hmm. I'm doing that because anybody really old can remember you turned out like a Gestetner.
I can't remember that. No, I have no idea.
I mean, people were standing up and writing with quills at this point. We were writing on parchment. This is way back in time. So 76, 77, and it was a much more open time commercially. So I hitchhiked down to London from Sheffield. So that's about 170 miles with a small suitcase with our fanzine. And I went to Rough Trade Records, our new sell fanzines, explained to them who I was. And they bought the whole lot off me. I said, yeah, we can. So and they distributed out. And so Gunrubber ended up being on sale in San Francisco and New York with
think about the level of influence that would have had.
We used to get letters to our workshop, you know, from like kids in Michigan and Georgia and stuff.
Amazing.
There's one kid who was in military school somewhere. And he said, I don't know where he got it. Possibly he'd gone on a visit to New York or something. And wrote to us. So, we were just having a hell of a lot of fun.
Right?
We didn't think it was going to go anywhere. I mean, it was only years later that I collected, I didn't have every copy of it. It was ephemeral.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the appeal for us was that it was ephemeral.
Right.
That this was just an explosive thing. We didn't have any idea that we were going to become music writers or anything. We were just doing our thing. Only later, the kind of penny dropped that we might be able to actually leave our jobs that we didn't like and make enough money to pay the rent by doing what we like.
Anakin, you kid, Dean Street will be spooking like McLaren. Okay, boys, you got to convince the shoppers.
Fuck off, bastard. Shit.
I prefer not to shut you. I like my mother. I want to get a nice job and grow up a decent bloke. But if you insist, mum. Tits! Spunk! Spunk, spunk! Anakin needs coordination. Where is Dirute and his Black Hand Gang? Because if we've got Dirute and his Black Hand Gang, we'd have McLaren swinging on a rope. Where is Dirute? Where's Dirante? Where are they now?
Publicity should be getting to what's happening in Sheffield, you know. Somebody farts in a paper bag in London, it's big news, you know. There's something good appeal, like we've had ideas and them things, and you get nothing. And so we thought we'd set something up, so punks without McLaren, punks without the pistol. They're all on the drone.
You did get to do what you wanted to.
Yeah, mainly. I mean, I was still working while I was in 2.3, so I had a full-time job.
Okay. And what was that experience like? You got a contract out of it, right?
Yeah, but only for one single.
What was the single?
The single was Where To Now. And I'll just play you the opening bars of it.
Yeah, I'd love that. That's where I was going.
Not the whole thing.
All right.
Cool.
And this is about the end of poem, the end of a scene, and a young girl looking back for what she thinks is like the best years of her life, but she's only 18. Now the freak show's over. Tourists have gone home. Magazines or trendy scenes hanging on your telephone. Cause now you're nearly 19. They say you're getting old. No camera click or leather chic. Now you're on your own. We've had a good time. This the old band played this. But now we've reached the end. We've had a good time. But now we've reached the end. Where to now? Where? And it goes on.
Right on. Well done, bud.
Awesome. Well done.
Awesome.
I do open mics just for fun and play.
Yeah, I was gonna say. So you left the music business, and now it seems like you're making a comeback now, and playing again more.
I'm playing again, and I really enjoy it. One of the reasons that I really enjoy it is that I've not got some delusion that I'm going to make it. I'll be the next, you know, Bruce Springsteen or Bob Dylan or Paul Weller. And I just enjoy it, and I enjoy the moment, and I enjoy playing. But the story about how I got back into playing music is interesting and very, very sad. So I'm not doing any music. I'm in touch with Martyn Ware. I follow what he's doing. So happy for his well-deserved success. Not into the music business at all. And I'm watching the TV with my two teenage daughters. And my phone pings. And it's a private message to say that the drummer from 2.3, Hayden Boys Weston, just a fantastic drummer. He could just do absolutely anything. He wasn't like one of those do punk drummers, paradiddles, riffs. He could do anything. He's a great drummer. The message was that he'd taken his own life and he'd sadly hanged himself. No warning, note or anything. And the guy is living in a beautiful house in the Cotswolds outside Oxfordshire. We all think everything's going well for him. We've not heard from him. And basically, he was a victim of depression, which kills a lot of people, men and women. And the old bass player got back in touch with me. Shall we just put the band back together and do a few songs? Which we did, and we self-produced and self-released an album with a lot of those songs. So there was like a 34 year gap between our first single and our first album. Hayden, who was just a really life and soul of the party, he would have thought that was hilarious. I'd written a few songs in the early 80s after I was out of the band, hoping to get other people to play them. But the first thing that I wrote after that huge gap was a song for Hayden, and it's called Excellent, because that was his favourite phrase. We're getting chased down the road by skinheads trying to beat us up. He'd be shouting, Excellent! He'd have a pint, a sandwich. Everything was for Hayden. He'd be leaning out a car with somebody driving at 70 miles an hour and me going, nah! Excellent! I'll just play you just a few lines from there. Everybody remember, he's the cool drummer, superb musician, a real musician. Reggae rim shot in your jazz syncopation. Dash of soul in a punk rock nation. Splash of colour for the blind generation. It's how we remember. It's how they do remember. Excellent you. Last night, I dreamt that I phoned you. On that day, where you stared down. Last week, we thought that we'd glimpse you. Head held high,
above the madded crowd. Think of you, we are still smiling. It's the best song I've ever written. It's the song I wish I'd have never written, because it wouldn't have happened had he not taken his life. And many times when I play that, there'll be somebody in the audience who'll come up and just say thanks for that, because a friend of mine took her life 2 weeks ago. A friend of mine took his life last year. We don't forget him. We still don't know why. We're still trying to process it. And his wife, Carol, was very appreciative, because it kind of summed up his vitality. And we just had no idea. We had no idea.
Well, this is a nice homage to him. He's going to live on the internet.
Thank you.
Nice.
Yeah.
Really done.
Well, cheers
nice
to
song,
him,
man. Really nice.
Cheers to him. Hey. Absolutely.
You play in London regularly? You have a regular gig in London?
Yeah, I was up in Sheffield and I played a little mini gig at a coffee bar.
What about but you live in London, right?
I do live in London, yeah. I may move back to Sheffield at some point. I may not. I still love London. I still love the buzz of London, the excitement of it. I came back to London because I'd had that brief spot running the junk shop and sleeping in a cellar. In the mid 60s to get involved in a kind of a political music project called Red Wedge with the Labour Party, when this is a time of the Labour Party is a vaguely socialist party. And I ended up again, goodness knows why, just pushing doors, helping launch a tour and a kind of, this is the height of Margaret Thatcher's power. A kind of cultural protest movement, but you know, I was very much a backroom boy in that. No playing music of any description, with Paul Weller, Billy Bragg, the Communards, and the great English soul artist, much underrated, Junior Giscombe. Ups and downs of different jobs. I'm a Spanish speaker. One job was setting business deals up in Spain and translating. Ended up working at an unemployment benefit office when that company went under, and just basically earning money to you know, pay the rent, then pay the mortgage, and bring two kids up. And I've had some fun and I've had some good jobs. I worked at the Millennium Dome, which was the largely disastrous attempt by the Blair government to have this big celebration of the millennium in the year 2000.
Right.
Awesome.
I was around.
I did sponsorships. So yeah. I moved away from being very much a.
Right on.
Are you going to
counterculture to being involved in the mainstream? I was basically selling tickets, selling sponsorship, really mainstream.
I saw your bio this earlier today, and it says here that your management career came to an abrupt end in an all-night drinking session with Dutch karate instructor. And I was like,
me too. Me too. I was like, wait a minute.
That's awesome.
We circled it.
Right, okay. I'm over with ABC and the band. And, you know, it's really stupid because I've really thrown away an opportunity here. But me and the band weren't getting on, really. And that was Martyn Fry and Mark White. And I knew really that maybe my management career with them was about to come to an end. They were going to do other things. They were doing some writing with a musician called Jody Walkley based in California, and we just had different views about the way that they should be developing their career. And I could see that this is so. I was just getting more and more cheesed off with the whole thing. So I went over on a trip to Amsterdam with them, to do a couple of TV shows. And I took one of my friends, the late Simon Hall, who he was a pretty excessive character. Let's just leave it there on every single
karate man.
I've had a couple in my day.
And
right here.
And so when we finished doing the recording, we went out drinking with the guy who'd been detailed by the record company to be our security.
Okay.
In case anything. And then we were drinking, I think we finished it about 5 a.m. What he called in Dutch is that it was a kick in the head. It was where you drop the gin into the beer.
Oh, yeah.
And it got a bit messy.
Yeah.
I only just got up in time, clearly reeking of booze. This is not the behavior. This is like you're a bad roadie.
What year is this? Are we talking about?
This will be about 86, 87. And
U2's big, man.
And obviously, I've spent some of the per diems, the pack. Sorry. and they're quite rightly very, very unhappy about that.
Sure.
They're absolutely in the right in this story. And I only just got up to make the plane, but we couldn't wake my friend Simon up at all. I thought, I hope he's not dead in there. We just couldn't wake him up. And we eventually managed to wake him up when, by the time we'd flown to London and I was in the office of the band. And I eventually got through to him. And he just said, "Bauer, what, Simon? Bastard. We tried to get you up, Simon. We tried." And so I eventually had to get the record company to pay to get my friend back, who had no money on him, get in the taxi and to get him on a plane to get back to London. Now, this is actually really bad behavior. Wow.
It's rock and roll, right?
Crazy. On,
exactly.
It's part of it, yeah. Paul. It's all good. And now you have a good story. It all worked out, you know.
So anyway, it didn't. But then around 30 years later, Mark White, half of the band, he was a guitarist, programmer, keyboard player, super talented guy, and a lovely guy to boot. He gets in touch with me through Facebook Messenger. Sam, Paul's in the bar. Good to see you doing well, etc. And let's meet up for a drink. And I said, "Oh, yeah, okay, Mark." So we met up in a Spanish tapas bar. And he walks through the door. I got there first. And I said, "Mark, I've got to get this straight out of the way, right away. I'm sorry for being such an ass, and I'm really sorry for that night in Amsterdam." And he put his hand on my hand and said, "Paul, it was the 80s. You did your very best for us. You did great promotion on the album. You're the best manager we had. And thank you very much. It's the 80s. We survived it. We're still alive. We should
still stay alive."
Well said.
And I said, "Oh, Mark, thanks." And we just had 6 hours of chatting, sipping nice wine. And I'm going to see New Order with him on Friday.
Okay.
We're on the guest list. It's another story. The stories continue forever.
Oh, well, yep. Let's not skip over. You're going to go see New Order?
Going to see New Order on Friday, yeah. A guy who's New Order's DJ befriended me on Facebook. We have similar ideas, similar politics, and similar devotion to drinking great wine and eating nice food. and then he just said, one of his favourite musicians and favourite producers is Mark White of ABC. He said, "Who's in touch with Mark?" I said, "Yep, Mark's a friend." And so I'm taking Mark White to meet New Order on Friday.
Wow.
Amazing.
Things going to happen.
Amazing. That's very, very cool.
Well, Mark, nice. New Order's DJ, a guy called Mark Hoof, wants Mark White of ABC to go back making music and producing people, because he says he's, as a DJ, I play stuff all the time. He was one of the first people in England to really understand and get into house music. And, so that's where I'll be on Friday, boys and girls.
Wow.
Right.
I got to tell you, Bizarre Love Triangle, one of my favorite songs. It gets me dancing. It gets me on the dance floor. I love singing it. I want you to dance. I'll be there in spirit, Paul.
Right. No, Paul, Daisy meant right now. She wants you to dance.
Well, sat down. They've probably got us a nice box or something.
Amazing.
One last question before we do we have like a rapid fire question thing at the end, but I got one last one. I think this ties in nicely. Is what would you recommend to someone who wants to go in the music business today?
Enjoy what you do. And don't expect to earn any money. Don't drive yourself mad going for success. Be yourself.
Do heroin.
And under no circumstances, do heroin.
You heard it here first, folks.
Under no circumstances. I'm being serious now. Lost two friends, sir.
There's gin and beer.
Right?
Do excess and then stop.
That's
the key is just exactly. Like alcohol, which has killed more people. The key is having a good time.
Have a good time.
Not actually like Spinal Tap. There's that great incidental character, Rick Savage, the keyboard player, said, "Have a good time all of the time."
So cool.
Just
so
that's
cool.
That's my motto right there.
You ready for a rapid fire?
Absolutely.
Okay. This is a two choice questionnaire to start with. City or countryside?
A city, always.
Club or concert?
Club.
Hmm. Acoustic or electric guitar?
Now acoustic.
Hmm. Analog or digital?
Totally analog.
I like it. Northern or southern England?
Northern England. But really, I prefer London, and London is not like Southern England. London is London.
Ooh.
Sheffield or London?
London.
Human League or Musical Vomit?
Ooh. You know, Musical Vomit, you know, with tracks like I Was a Teenage Necrophiliac, still unplayed nearly 50 years later. We couldn't broadcast them. Impossible to broadcast them. I've got to go for the Human League. Particularly the first two albums, and particularly the second album, Travelogue. Worth investigating.
Berlin or Amsterdam?
I've never been to Berlin. I'd love to. I really love Amsterdam.
Yeah, me too. Potato or potato?
Potato, but I've cut down potatoes and managed to lose a bit of weight.
Tomato or tomato?
Well, it's clearly tomato.
I love it. Okay, this is the first thing that comes to mind. Canada.
Quiet.
USA.
Oh. Vibrant chaos, but I do love it.
EU.
EU, better than the alternatives.
UK.
In a bad place at the moment.
Favorite city?
Do you know, I still think it's London.
Football, like soccer?
Not really interested.
UFOs?
Be nice if they existed and sorted us all out, made us more peaceful.
Your comfort food?
Fish and chips.
Music?
Essential.
Your superpower?
Making friends.
Your paradise?
Paradise is being in the arms of somebody you love.
Oh, nice. Thank you, Paul.
I like that. Thank you for coming
Thank
on our
you.
Show. We are
so grateful. Gracias, Dasi. Guys, it's just been a complete pleasure. Thank you.
Yes.
Muchísimas gracias, Paul.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Adios. Bye, everybody. I'll be back in touch.
Yeah, we'll be in touch.